Hello everyone, welcome to this session on the brachial plexus. This is one of the most important topic to be studied in upper limbs. I'm covering this topic. So I'll be covering this topic under following headings. We'll see what is the definition of brachial plexus, what are the components of brachial plexus, then various branches of brachial plexus, then the two important applied anatomy related to it, Erb's paralysis and Klumke's paralysis. And lastly, I'll cover some multiple choice questions related to this topic. So let's begin with the definition. What is brachial plexus? Brachial plexus is the plexus of the nerve formed by the anterior, also called as the ventral rami of lower four cervical nerves and the first thoracic spinal nerve. Okay, so C5, C6, C7, C8 and T1, they form the brachial plexus. Remember, only ventral rami, they form the plexus. This is a cross section of the spinal cord. Supposing this is the dorsal root, this is the ventral root. They unite to form the spinal nerve, which divides into a dorsal ramus and a ventral ramus. Okay, the ventral ramus gives rise to the brachial plexus. Now let's cover the various components of the brachial plexus. So there are four major components. They can be remembered by a mnemonic: R, T, D, C. Okay, R stands for the roots, T stands for trunk, D stands for the division, and C stands for the cords of the brachial plexus. And cords further give branches. Okay, so these are the various components of the brachial plexus. If we see roots and the trunks, they are located above the clavicle. Supposing the clavicle bone is here, the roots and the trunks are above the clavicle. The divisions are behind the clavicle and cords are below the clavicle. So this is one anatomical landmark which you can remember to identify the various location of the components of the brachial plexus. Okay. So if you see the brachial plexus, it looks very complicated, but we'll try to simplify it and easily remember all the components of brachial plexus. Okay. So let's try to draw a simplified line diagram to understand the various components of brachial plexus. So here I've listed down the five spinal segments which give rise to the brachial plexus: C5, C6, C7, C8, and T1. Okay. So these are the five roots. At times there may be contribution from C4 as well. In that condition, the brachial plexus is referred to as prefixed brachial plexus. And when there is contribution from T2, the brachial plexus is referred to as post-fixed brachial plexus. Okay, but in general, these are the five components. So C5 and C6 roots unite to form the upper trunk of the brachial plexus. C7 continues as the middle trunk of the brachial plexus. C8 and T1, they unite to form the lower trunk of the brachial plexus. Okay, so this is the roots and these are the trunks. Remember the formula R, T, D, C. So R, T we have covered. Then it will lead to D and C. Okay. So what are D? D refers to the division. The trunk divides into divisions. Upper trunk will divide into an anterior division and posterior division. Middle trunk will divide into anterior division and posterior division. Similarly, lower trunk will divide into anterior division and posterior division. Okay. So these are the various divisions of the brachial plexus. Then divisions lead to the cords of the brachial plexus. To remember the cords of the brachial plexus, let's start with the posterior cord. Posterior cord is formed by the union of the posterior division of all the three components of brachial plexus: posterior division of upper trunk, posterior division of middle trunk, and posterior division of lower trunk. If we unite these three, it will lead to the formation of the posterior cord of the brachial plexus. Okay. Anterior division of the upper trunk and anterior division of the middle trunk, they unite to form the lateral cord of the brachial plexus. Okay. So there is only one division which is remaining, that is the anterior division of the lower trunk. That will continue as the medial cord of the brachial plexus. Okay, so these are the three major cords of the brachial plexus, and they are named lateral, posterior, and medial according to their relation with the axillary artery. Supposing here is the second part of the axillary artery, the cord lateral to the axillary artery is lateral cord, the cord posterior to the axillary artery is posterior cord, the cord medial to the axillary artery is medial cord. Okay, this relation is specific for the second part of the axillary artery. Now let's cover the branches of the brachial plexus. First we'll start with the branches from the roots. From the roots, if we see C5, C6 and C7, they unite to form a nerve which is referred to as nerve to serratus anterior, also referred to as long thoracic nerve, also referred to as nerve of Bell, which supplies the serratus anterior muscle. There is one nerve arising directly from C5 that is referred to as dorsal scapular nerve, okay, also referred to as nerve to rhomboids. Then from the upper trunk of the brachial plexus, there are two nerves. One is suprascapular nerve and other is nerve to subclavius. Okay, this region is referred to as Erb's point, because there are six nerves which are meeting here, the C5 and C6 spinal segments, then these two nerves, and then the anterior and the posterior divisions of the upper trunk. Okay, this region is referred to as Erb's point. In Erb's paralysis, injury occurs in this region. And there are no branches from the divisions. Okay, this we should remember. There are branches from the roots, there are branches from the trunks, there are branches from the cords. There are no branches from the divisions. Okay, branches from the cords we'll be covering now. Branches from the lateral cord can be remembered by a mnemonic LML. Okay, where L stands for the lateral pectoral nerve, M stands for the musculocutaneous nerve, and again L stands for the lateral root of the median nerve. Okay, then branches from the medial cord are remembered by a mnemonic M4U. Okay, 4 times M and a U. 2M we can remember by comparing with these two L. There is lateral pectoral nerve here, so here there is medial pectoral nerve. There is lateral root of the median nerve here, so here there is medial root of the median nerve. Okay, and there are two cutaneous branches, one to the arm and one to the forearm. Okay, so the name is medial cutaneous nerve of the arm and medial cutaneous nerve of the forearm, and U stands for the ulnar nerve. Okay, then coming to the branches from the posterior cord of the brachial plexus, mnemonic for this is ulnar. Okay, remember only the mnemonic is ulnar. Actual nerve, ulnar nerve, arises from the medial cord. Okay, here the U stands for upper subscapular nerve, L stands for the lower subscapular nerve, N stands for the nerve to latissimus dorsi, A stands for axillary nerve, and R stands for the radial nerve. Okay, so these are the various branches from the cords of the brachial plexus. Now let's cover applied anatomy related to it. There's an applied anatomy which is referred to as Erb's paralysis. As we all know, Erb's point is the region of the upper trunk of the brachial plexus where six nerves meet. So if there is injury in that region, that it is referred to as Erb's paralysis. How is the mechanism of injury? Excessive increase in the angle between the head and the shoulder leads to Erb's paralysis. Okay, nerve roots involved are C5 and C6. The typical deformity of the limb is this. There is adduction of the arm, medial rotation of the arm, extension of the elbow, and pronation of the forearm. We'll try to understand the anatomical basis of this position. Adduction of the arm is due to the paralysis of the deltoid muscle. Deltoid muscle is supplied by axillary nerve. Root value is C5 and C6. Okay, since deltoid is the abductor of the arm, it is paralyzed, arm will go in adduction. And there is medial rotation of the arm because the lateral rotators are paralyzed, the infraspinatus, teres minor. Okay, then extension of the elbow, the biceps brachii, brachialis, they cause flexion of the elbow. If they are paralyzed, it will lead to extension of the elbow. Then pronation of the forearm, why is it so? Because the biceps brachii is also a supinator of the forearm. If it is paralyzed, it will lead to pronation of the forearm. Okay, and this deformity is referred to as policeman's stiff hand, also referred to as porter's stiff hand, also referred to as waiter's stiff hand. Okay, so these are the various things which we should be knowing about Erb's paralysis. Now let's cover one more applied anatomy related to the brachial plexus. That is Klumpke's paralysis. Klumpke's paralysis is caused due to hyperabduction of the arm. For example, if falling from a tree, if someone catches an object, it leads to hyperabduction of the arm. In that condition, the lower trunk of the brachial plexus is injured. The root value of lower trunk is C8 and T1. Okay? And this is the important root value for ulnar nerve. Ulnar nerve has root value of C7, C8 and T1. Majorly it is C8 and T1. So the structures supplied by the ulnar nerve will be affected in Klumpke's paralysis. There is a clinical condition called as claw hand, in which there is hyperextension at the metacarpophalangeal joint and flexion at the interphalangeal joint. This occurs due to the paralysis of the lumbricals and introsei muscle, which are supplied by the ulnar nerve. Okay, and there is loss of sensation along the medial border of the forearm, which is supplied by the T1 spinal segment. And there is also a condition which is called as Horner's syndrome. Because the T1 sympathetic fibers are affected, it leads to Horner's syndrome. It manifests as ptosis, meiosis, anhydrosis. Okay, all these are the features of Horner's syndrome, due to the sympathetic fibers of T1 getting affected. Now let's cover some multiple choice question pertaining to this topic. So this is the question: which of the following nerve carries fibers from all the roots of the brachial plexus? All the roots means C5 to T1. Which nerve has components from all the roots of the brachial plexus? Axillary nerve has root value C5 and C6. Ulnar nerve has root value C7, C8 and T1. Thoracodorsal nerve, it is also called as nerve to latissimus dorsi. Root value is C6, C7 and C8. So this nerve which is remaining. Median nerve, what is the root value of median nerve? Median nerve, it is actually formed by the union of lateral root of the median nerve and medial root of the median nerve. Okay. For lateral root of median nerve, root value is C5, C6 and C7. For medial root of the median nerve, root value is C8 and T1. Okay. That's how the entire components of the brachial plexus are taking part in the formation of median nerve. Okay. Now let's cover an image-based question pertaining to this topic. First, orient yourself towards this image. This is the right-sided axilla. This is the lateral aspect. This is the superior aspect. This is the region of brachial plexus. So a nerve has been pointed out and it has to be identified. Which nerve is this? So to identify this nerve, we can see this nerve is going towards a muscle and it is piercing that muscle. This muscle is coracobrachialis. Okay. This muscle is coracobrachialis. Which nerve pierces the coracobrachialis muscle? That's the musculocutaneous nerve. Okay. So that's how we can identify this nerve. In practical examinations, whenever any component of brachial plexus is asked to identify, for always we should start with the musculocutaneous nerve, one of the easiest nerve to identify, because we can see it will be piercing the muscle, that is coracobrachialis. And there is something called as M pattern of the brachial plexus, which we should be knowing. We'll see now here what is the M pattern. This is the musculocutaneous nerve. This is the ulnar nerve. Okay. I'm drawing an M here like this. Okay. So in this M, one limb of the M is formed by the musculocutaneous nerve. Other limb of the M is formed by the ulnar nerve. And the intermediate V-shaped part is formed by the two roots of the median nerve. Okay. This is the lateral root of median nerve and this is the medial root of the median nerve. Once we have identified the musculocutaneous nerve, we can trace it backwards and we'll reach the lateral cord of the brachial plexus. From the lateral cord, we all know there is a lateral root of the median nerve and it is united by the medial root of the median nerve. That's how we can reach the medial cord of the brachial plexus. Okay. And one of the most prominent branches on the medial cord of the brachial plexus is this. That's the ulnar nerve. Okay. So that's how, by this M pattern, we can identify all the major branches of the brachial plexus. For radial nerve, It will be posterior to the axillary artery, and it is the thickest of all the nerves from the brachial plexus. Okay. So let's summarize what we have covered in this session. We started off with the definition of the brachial plexus. Brachial plexus is ventral primary rami of C5, C6, C7, C8, and T1, which supply the upper limb. Then these are the various components we can remember by the mnemonic RT, DC. Okay. Chords further give rise to branches. Okay. Branches. We learnt about the branches from the roots, branches from the trunks. Divisions doesn't have any branch. Then there are branches from the chords. Branches from the chords can be remembered by mnemonic. Branches from the lateral chord can be remembered by LML. Branches from the medial chord can be remembered by this mnemonic, M4U. And branches from the posterior chord are remembered by this mnemonic, Ulnar. Okay. Then in applied anatomy, we learnt about Erb's paralysis and Plumke's paralysis. In Erb's paralysis, the injury is in the upper trunk of the brachial plexus. Nerve roots involved are C5 and C6. In Plumke's paralysis, injury is in the lower trunk of the brachial plexus. The nerve roots involved are C8 and T1. Okay. So this was all about this particular session. If you all have any doubts, then you all can ask in the comments section below. Okay. Thank you.